Literature has a very long and revered history in Korea that goes back millennia. But in the 20th century in particular, literature in Korea has been very intimately interwoven with urgent questions addressing truth affecting the entire collectivity. Defined against a turbulent history that shuttled Korean people through one agonizing collective experience after another, including, as you all know, colonialism, imperialism, a devastating experience with war, with national division, with several authoritarian governments, rapid industrialization, and a spectacular but controversy-ridden emergence into the glittering world of the global capital that we see all around us today. We are very privileged this afternoon to have with us two literary voices that work through both this past, troubled as it may be, and presage things to come in a very distinctive and sometimes iconoclastic ways. Writers Shin Kyung-soo and Kim Young-ha are without a doubt two of the most exciting, ingenious, moving, also well-appreciated voices writing in Korea today. And though their writing emerged from contexts that are specific to Korea and Korean society, such as in Mr. Kim's case, the psychological and political convolutions of the national division manifested in their lives and the figure of a North Korean spy living in South Korea, or the growingly poignant and troubled problem of the elderly in a society that makes almost everything obsolete in a blink of an eye, and that is the Korean reality, especially in the South today. The meditations in these works take us both deeper into those problems and beyond their immediate contexts, and they force us indeed to ask very discomforting and unsettling questions about how we live here and now in Ann Arbor in 2010 on the big homecoming day. Both writers also have in common the rare and wonderful fact of commanding both the critical acclaim of finicky literary people like us in the academia and huge commercial success among the readership in Korea. The format of today's event is an interesting format, and we are very lucky to have this format, is to have both a fiction reading session and a presentation from the writers about their works, the kinds of issues they face, the problems that they resolve through their writing, and then to have a larger Q&A session during which I think the audience can get even closer, even lower beneath the skin of the writers and their works. And in this process, we have the help of a wonderful, in fact, the leading scholar of Korean literature here in the U.S., Professor Kyung-hee Choi of University of Chicago, and she'll be helping us with the translation. Ms. Shin will be reading from her novel, 엄마를 부탁해, a bestseller in Korean, and due out in the U.S. in 2011. Again, a moving story, also a troubling story, about the generations within a family and the deep secrets and the revelations that arise on the occasion of a mother's sudden disappearance. Mr. Kim will be reading from his book, already out on Amazon, and I'm told in just a few weeks since its release, it's already number 30 in terms of volume sold. Republic, your Republic is calling you a Kafka-esque, according to a critic. One critic, a Murakami Haruki-esque, according to another critic. Meditation on, again, the psychological and political convolutions of this present moment through the perspective of a North Korean spy living in South Korea. Now, yesterday, some of us had a rare opportunity to sit down with the writers and hear from them their thoughts about literature. And during that conversation, Mr. Kim Young-ha was asked what it is that motivates his writing of fiction specifically. And his answer was very memorable. He said, he writes fiction because he knows and believes that there are some stories in this world that beg to be told that cannot be told in any way but the most roundabout and circuitous route. And so I would like to invite you to a wonderful afternoon of a delightful meanderings through their literature. And so please welcome me, please join me in welcoming Ms. Shin Kyung-suk and Professor Choi Kyung-hee first to the podium for their first session.
(웃음) 나는 왜 글을 쓰는가? 가장 할 말이 많아야 하는 대목인데 나는 항상 이 질문에 늘 전전긍긍해요. 최선을 다해서 이렇게 말해봐도 아닌 것 같고 저렇게 말해봐도 아닌 것 같아요. 일찍부터 작가가 아닌 나 자신을 생각해본 적이 없음에도 그러합니다. 어쩌면 해답은 거기에 있는 것인지도 모르겠어요. 부정확한 것, 시비가 가려지지 않는 것, 뭐라고 형언할 수 없는 것, 이를테면 말해질 수 없는 것. 내 작품은 그런 세계를 토대로 쓰여지고 있다고 생각합니다. 내가 살아보려고 했으나 마음 붙이지 못한 것들, 슬픔들, 헤어짐들, 아름다움들, 사라져버린 것들, 과학적인 접근으로는 닿지 못할 논리 밖의 세계들, 그런 말해질 수 없는 것들이요. 이미 삶이 찌그러져 버렸거나 아무도 알아주지 않는 익명의 존재들에게 생기를 불어넣어주고 싶은 그런 마음, 도처에 어른거리는 죽음 후 그림자나 시간 앞에 무기력한 사랑, 불가능한 것을 향한 매달림, 여기 없는 것에 대한 그리움, 이 말해질 수 없는 것들을 내 글쓰기로 재현해내고 싶은 꿈, 이미 사라지고 없는 것들을 불러와서 유연하게 본질에 닿게 하고 자연의 냄새에 잠기게 하고 싶은 꿈, 그렇게 해서 이 순간을 영원히 가둬놓고 싶은 실현 불가능한 꿈, 아마 내 소설 속엔 어디에나 이런 나의 꿈이 묻어있을 것입니다.
Why do I write? I should have plenty to say about this, but I always find myself at a loss for words. No answer feels just right. Even the best of my answers often sounds inaccurate. Even though I've never thought of myself as anything other than a writer, the question of why I write puzzles me. Why I write puzzles me just the same. Perhaps my answer can be found in that ambivalence on certain things. Things that are neither right nor wrong, those that cannot be captured so easily or expressed so clearly in words, the world of my fiction is founded upon these. Sadness, beauty, goodbyes from those I have tried my best to live with. Things that are gone and no more, the world beyond the rational riches of science. The desire to breathe life back into what is broken and nameless and unknown, love that turns to dust in time, longing for what is not here, inability to let go of what has already been proven impossible. I dream of recreating these things things that cannot be talked about. I dream of recalling into existence the things that are gone and no more, so that they may once again unite them with their quintessence and bask in the smell of nature. I dream an impossible dream of preserving for eternity this brief moment. Such a dream is buried in my works. The dream, however, remains buried, and my fiction continues to write progress in its tottering, imperfect way.
하지만 꿈은 묻어 있을 뿐, 내 소설은 불완전하게 계속 진행되고 있는 과정에 있습니다. 인간은 누구든 글을 읽지 못하는 아주 어린 아이 때부터 이야기를 들으며 성장합니다. 나도 이야기를 들으며 성장했습니다. 눈이 내리는 날 산에서 배고픈 호랑이가 내려와 장독대의 된장을 퍼먹고 간다든가, 집안에 나쁜 일이 생기려고 하면 지킴이라고 불리는 구렁이가 지붕에서 마당으로 기어나온다든가, 그런 이야기를 들으며 성장했습니다. 호랑이는 그때만 등장하는 게 아닙니다. 어쩌다 떼를 쓰고 울게 되면 어머니는 우는 아이는 호랑이가 등에 태우고 산속 깊은 곳으로 데려가서 훈훈해진다고 해서 더 울지도 못하겠죠. 어린 마음에 호랑이 등에 타는 것도 무섭고 산속 깊은 곳 세상도 두려워서 울음을 뚝 그치곤 했던 것 같아요. 이렇게 이야기는 한 인간이 처해 있는 상황에 따라서 그때그때마다 탄생됩니다. 말하자면 인간을 성장시키기 위해 발굴되는 수많은 이야기들 속에 인류는 둘러싸여 있는 것이기도 할 테죠.
We all grew up listening to stories from very early age. Even before we learned to read, I too grew up listening to stories. Stories about a hungry tiger that descends from the mountains on a snowy day and feeds on the bean paste kept in the crock jar outside. Or about large snake called Guardian that crawls out into the yard to forebode misfortunes on the way. The tigers make frequent appearance in old tales. Tigers carry crying children on their backs into the mountain and teach them a lesson. My mother used to tell me whenever I threw a temper tantrum, I stopped crying right away. I guess I was afraid of riding a tiger's back and entering a world I knew nothing about. Stories are born out of various situations we face as individuals. We're surrounded by countless stories that have been invented to assist our development as human beings.
멋진 표현이기도 하겠으나 성경과 불경을 포함한 숱한 경전들도 결국 이야기라고 생각합니다. 숱한 신화들과 민속 신앙들과 영웅 신앙들도 인류가 남긴 이야기라고 생각해요. 인류는 왜 이런 이야기들을 남겼을까? 그 이야기들을 발판 삼아 딛고 앞으로 나아가라는 뜻은 아니었을까요? 어느 시대를 살든 그때 함께 살고 있는 동시대인들은 동시대인들끼리 공동으로 경험하는 삶 속에서 상징이 될 만한 그런 새로운 이야기를 계속 탄생시키며 끊임없이 지나왔다고 봅니다. 지금은 디지털 시대에도 인류가 서로 소통할 수 있는 매개는 이야기가 중심이라고 나는 생각해요. 디지털은 빠른 속도로 이야기를 유포시켜서 이제는 우리가 지구 어디에 살고 있든 단 몇 분 만에 어디서 무슨 일이 일어나는지 알 수 있죠. 지구 이 끝과 저 끝에서 발생하는 이야기가 1, 2분 안에 세계인이 소통하고 공유할 수 있는 이런 시대에 살게 될 줄 누가 알았겠어요. 이렇게 소통이 신속하기 때문에 이야기는 더욱더 인류의 강력한 희망이 될 수 있다고 나는 생각합니다. 폭력과 고통이 빠르게 전달되기도 하지만 근원적인 삶에 대한 성찰과 따뜻한 온기에 대한 이야기도 동시에 빠르게 전해집니다. 무의식적으로 좋은 것을 받아들이고 좋은 쪽으로 변화하려고 하는 것이 인간의 본성이라고 본다면 새로운 질서와 새로운 꿈을 꾸게 하는 이야기들이 무수하게 탄생되어 이런 문명의 힘을 입어 아주 빠르게 퍼지며 세계를 소통시킨다고 생각해요. 경제 공황, 끊이지 않는 테러, 갈수록 심해지는 빈부 격차, 전쟁의 위협 앞에 놓여있는 인류 마음을 움직일 수 있는 거의 유일한 것이 이야기이지 않을까요? 이야기와 이야기들이 인류를 연결하고 변화시키고 굳은 마음을 녹게 할 겁니다. 내가 작품 속에서 탄생시키는 이야기들도 해결되지 않는 문제들 때문에 절망에 차 있는 사람들과 소통하기를 희망합니다.
Perhaps I am being too simplistic, but I believe that even the sacred scriptures like the Bible and the Buddhist sutras are essentially stories, as they are the mythologies, folk legends, and heroic tales. Why did our ancestors leave such a legacy of stories behind? Were they trying to tell us to move forward with these stories as stepping stones? Each era, each generation gives birth to new stories that represent the shared experiences particular to that time period. Even in the digital age, I believe stories are the main conduit of human communication. We live in a time when information can be transmitted to the remotest corners of the earth in a matter of minutes. Who could have guessed that we would ever live in an age when stories can spread around the world globe so quickly? And because of the increased speed of transmission, stories can provide even more powerful hope for humanity. News of violence and suffering travel around the globe with blinding speed, it is true. But so do the stories of human kindness and deeper contemplation on life. If it is in our nature to accept what is good and to strive to make positive changes in our lives, then we will continue to create stories about new orders, new dreams, which, aided by modern technology, will spread around the world and facilitate greater communication. What other than stories can move the hearts grown desolate by economic depression, ceaseless terrors, increasing gap between the rich and the poor, and constant threats of war? Stories melt hardened hearts, unite people, and change them for the better. I hope that my writing will find resonance among the downtrodden, among the people struggling with the difficult problems.
나는 시골에서 자랐는데요. 내가 자란 마을엔 철길이 놓여 있었습니다. 상행선 기차는 사람들을 서울로 데려갔고 하행선 기차는 사람들을 더 남쪽으로 데려가곤 했어요. 그 철길을 사이에 두고 이편 저편에 들판이 있었습니다. 물론 우리 집 논도 거기 있었죠. 나는 기차가 지나가면 무엇을 하고 있건 간에 멈춰서 기차를 향해 손을 힘껏 흔들었어요. 가끔 기차 안에서도 모르는 사람들이 나를 향해 손을 마주 흔들어주기도 했습니다. 무의식적인 행위였지만 나는 기차를 타고 먼 곳으로 떠나는 사람들을 마음속으로 선망했어요. 나도 그 기차를 타고 그 마을을 떠나게 되기를 바랬죠. 그 기찻길은 내게 수많은 죽음을 목도하게 했습니다. 집에서 기르던 개가 추수가 한창 논으로 가던 내 뒤를 따라오다가 기차에 치이기도 했고, 술을 먹고 철길을 베고 잠이 든 사람은 머리통이 날아가기도 했고, 살아가는 것에 더 이상 의욕이 없는 일가족이 그 길에서 목숨을 버리기도 했어요. 기차는 사고 난 지점으로부터 500m쯤 지나야 멈춥니다. 기차의 속도는 제어할 수 없이 빨라서 기관사가 물체를 발견하고 브레이크를 밟는다고 해도 그 속도 때문에 사고를 방지할 수가 없습니다. 발견을 했는데도 이미 늦는 거예요. 나는 이해할 수 없는 이런 죽음들을 수도 없이 목도하며 성장했습니다.
I grew up in the countryside. A railroad cut across my hometown, carrying people further south or up north to Seoul. And on either side of the tracks was a field. Rice paddies belonging to my family could be found near the tracks. When a train passed by, I would stop whatever I was doing and wave towards it. Subconsciously, I envied people in the train heading for distant places. I wished that I too could live on a train. That rail tracks was also where I got to witness so many deaths. My dog, trailing me through the field during a harvest, was run over by a train. A drunkard who had fallen asleep with the tracks as his neck support lost his head in sleep. And a family who no longer saw any reason for living gave up on life on the tracks. The train would stop 500 meters past the point of impact. Even if the driver discovered an object on the track and braked hard, the train could not decelerate fast enough. It would have been too late by then. I grew up watching numerous instances of such incomprehensible death.
언제부턴가 이런 일들을 노트에 적기 시작했습니다. 이해할 수가 없었기 때문에요. 처음에는 그냥 쓰기 시작했는데 점점 노트에 적는 일들이 중요해졌어요. 처음엔 현실에서 발생하는 일만 쓰기 시작했으나 점점 상상력이 덧붙여져서 꿈과 희망과 비밀들이 쓰여지기 시작했어요. A를 A라 쓰지 않고 A, B라고 시작하니까 현실의 일들을 나만 알아볼 수 있는 그런 희열이 있었습니다. 일이 잘 풀려서 기쁘고 행복한 날에는 아무것도 쓰지 않았습니다. 반대로 마음이 슬프고 아픈 날에는 쓰는 시간이 길어졌습니다. 어느덧 혼자 몰래 써보는 일은 꿈과 희망을 실어나르기 시작했고 이 세상의 일들과 나의 내밀한 욕망들이 다른 이야기들을 불러들이며 덧붙여지기 시작했어요. 그러자 노트 안에서는 희한한 일이 일어나기 시작했죠. 내가 보고 느끼는 것들만이 아니라 눈에 보이지 않는 것, 멀리 있는 것, 여기가 아닌 저기가 서로 섞여고 엮이고 짜여지면서 현실의 또 하나의 세계를 일구었어요.
I began to write them down in my notebook, and the act of writing gradually took on more importance. At first, I merely recorded what happened, but in time, my imagination found its way into the notebook, and I began to write about my dreams and hopes, as well as my secrets. A was no longer just as an A, but an AB in my notebook, a transformation recognizable only to myself, and it brought me a great pleasure. I wrote nothing on those days when everything went well and I was happy. When I was filled with pain and sadness, on the other hand, I found myself writing for a long time. The writing, which I did in secret, began to convey dreams and hopes, and my intimate desires, merging with the events of the world, give rise to new stories. Then something strange began to take place in my notebook. What I couldn't see, what was not here, but there, far away, intertwined to shape a new reality apart from the one based on what I could see and feel.
현실에서는 가능하지 않은 이야기들이 노트 안에서는 가능해지기 시작했어요. 타자에게 전달되지 않은 채 오해만 일으켰던 이야기들이 노트 안에서는 소통을 이루며 풍성한 밭을 일구어 나갔어요. 형제가 많은 속에서 자라는 동안에 무수히 침범당하는 내 개인의 일상 또한 노트 안에서는 무한대로 자유로웠습니다. 나는 그 자유 때문에 점점 노트를 사랑하기 시작했어요. 내 주변에 내가 본 모든 일들을 다 문장으로 바꿔보려는 게 습관이 되어갔어요. 나중에는 아무 일이 없어도 문장을 쓰는 것 자체를 즐겨서 내가 좋아하는 시나 소설을 노트에 빼곡하게 옮겨 적는 일들이 청년기까지 반복되었습니다.
What was not possible in this reality became possible in my notebook, and misunderstood stories that never found a listener interlinked and connected one another, forming a vast, fertile field. My days, marked with so many invasions and interferences from my brothers and sisters, were free and private in my notebook. For that freedom, I began to love my notebook. It became a habit to try to render everything I saw around me into the written language. I grew to love sentences. I came to enjoy building sentences so much that Even on an uneventful way, I would fill a notebook with poems and stories I copied from other books. This continued well into my teenage years.
고등학교 다닐 때 만난 은사가 내게 반성문을 쓰게 한 적이 있습니다. 무단 결석이 길어져서 그때 나는 제적 대상이었거든요. 시골을 떠나 도시를 이주해온 나는 적응을 못했어요. 사랑하는 것들은 멀리 있었고 이해할 수 없는 일들이 날마다 발생했고 어쩌다 마음을 붙이고 지내보려고 하는 관계는 어긋났고 도시에서 만난 사람들은 모두 화가 난 사람들처럼 각자들 다른 곳을 향해 걸어다니는 것 같았어요. 반성문에 이런 이야기들을 쓰다 보니 노트 방문이 채워졌어요. 무슨 문장을 썼는지 지금은 다 잊었어요. 갑자기 도시 빈민자가 되어버린 불합리한 삶을 에워싸고 있는 암호 같은 이야기들을 나열해 놓았을 겁니다. 쓴 나조차도 해독할 수 없는 말더듬이의 말이었을 거예요. 그럼에도 불구하고 은사는 반성문을 읽어보고 내게 소설가가 되어보라 했어요. 꿈이 필요했던 내게 그 말은 하늘에서 떨어진 별 같았죠. 반성문을 통해 소설가가 되라는 말을 처음 들어서인지 가끔 나는 내 소설이 이 세계와 개인적인 내 삶이 저질러 놓은 오류에 대한 반성문 같다는 생각을 가끔 합니다. 그럴지도 모릅니다. 한순간도 멈춰있지 않고 움직이는 이 삶 속에서 살아가면서 내가 저버릴 수밖에 없었던 인간관계, 나도 모르는 사이에 배신해버렸던 세계, 나로 인해 삶이 흔들려버렸을지도 모를 타자를 향한 반성문이 내 소설일지도 모릅니다. 작가란 보지 말아야 할 것을 보아버린 운명의 소유자들입니다. 그렇지 않고서야 밤낮없이 형들 같은 의자에 앉아있기를 자청하겠나요? 내가 보아버린 그것이 무엇인지 모른 채로 오늘도 나는 글을 쓰고 있어요. 영원히 그것이 무엇인지 모르고 작가 생활이 끝날 수도 있겠지만 한 가지는 압니다. 내 작품은 나와 소유자들을 위해서 쓰여졌다는 것, 명랑하고 즐거운 사람들보다 슬프고 아픈 사람들을 위해 쓰여졌다는 것, 해결되지 않은 것, 금지된 것, 패배한 것들을 편히 잊고자 했다는 것, 내가 무엇을 주제로 작품을 썼든 내 이야기들은 억압에 저항하는 자유의 속성을 지니고 있다고 생각합니다. 가장 아름다웠던 순간들이 가장 큰 슬픔을 남기며 상실되어가는 것을 언어로 지켜보고 있었다고도 생각합니다. 글을 쓸 수 있었기 때문에 진실이 남기고 간 발자국들, 태어남과 동시에 이루어지는 소멸들, 이해하기 힘든 불합리적인 것들, 설명하려 하면 할수록 해체되어지는 것들, 가까이 다가갈수록 멀어지는 것들과 함께 할 수 있었어요. 그런 상황들을 견뎌낼 수 있었습니다. 내가 슬펐을 때 문학작품이 나를 위로하였듯이 내 작품도 슬픔에 빠진 사람들 곁에 함께 있기를 바랍니다.
Once my high school teacher made me write a letter of apology. I'd been absent so many times that I was facing expulsion. I'd moved to the city and I was having a difficult time adjusting to the new environment. Everything I loved was far away. Days were full of incomprehensible events and what few relationships I tried to nurture went awry. In the city, everyone seemed as if they were angrily stomping off to different places. I quickly filled up half of my notebook with observations like these. I forgot what exactly I wrote, but my guess is that I'd probably written down enigmatic stories surrounding my sudden, illogical transformation into an urban poor. It was probably something akin to a stutter. Sometimes even myself couldn't understand. Despite it all, my teacher told me that I should try my hand at becoming a writer. Starved for hope, I hung on to her words as though they were stars dropped from heaven. Maybe it's only because a letter of apology brought me a recommendation to become a writer, but I sometimes wonder if my work is itself a letter of apology. Apology for my mistakes, as well as for the wrong committed in this world. It seems likely. My work may well be an apology offered up to all the relationships I failed to maintain in the hustle and bustle of daily life, to the world I turned my back on unknowingly, to the people whose lives I might have disrupted. Writers must force themselves to see what they shouldn't be seen. Such is their fate. Why else would they, of their own free will, endure the torture of being confined to a chair day in and day out? Even today, I continue to write, not even knowing what it is that I've seen. I may never know it, even to the end of my own days as a writer, but I'm sure of one thing. I write for myself and for those people on the fringe who are full of sadness and pain, not joy and laughter. I strive to stand on the side of the unresolved, the forgiven, forbidden, or the vanquished. Regardless of the subject matter, if I'd like to think, my stories share that essential nature of freedom, which is the resistance to oppression. With my language, I follow those beautiful moments as they disappear, leaving only the sadness behind. Because I can write, I can endure the shape of truth left behind, birth accompanied by concomitant extinction, absurdities that defy comprehension, things that become more obscure as you try to explain them, distances that grow the more you try to bridge them. Literature consoled me when I was sad. I hope that my work, too, will stay a companion to those overcome by sadness.
내 작품의 가장 밑바탕에 깔려 있는 것은 연민일 겁니다. 내게 영감을 주는 것들이 느끼면 대개가 저거 참 가엽다, 안 됐다 하는 것들이니까요. 그것들이 내게 머물면 소설이 됩니다. 태어나서 살아가고 죽는 사이에 가장 찬란한 순간, 우리가 청춘이라고 부르는 그런 순간이 만물에게 존재하죠. 그 순간이 영원히 계속되지 않기 때문에 나는 씁니다. 생명 있는 것들이 한순간도 가만히 있지 않고 변화하기 때문에 나는 씁니다. 그 존엄과 아름다움과 고통과 비애들을요. 내 작품들이 소외된 것들의 문제를 해결하지는 못하더라도 그것을 따뜻히 껴안으며 그들과 함께 있기를 바라면서 씁니다. 연민은 어머니 마음의 가장 근접한 감정이고 결핍되고 모순되고 불합리한 것들을 돌보는 것은 상징이 어머니 마음이라면 내게 소설 쓰기는 이런 어머니의 마음 가장 가까이 가는 것입니다. 나의 근작 장편 소설 중에 엄마를 부탁해가 있어요. 엄마에게도 엄마가 필요하다는 인식하에 쓰여진 작품입니다. 어느 날 갑자기 복잡한 지하철역 안에서 엄마를 잃어버리고 난 후에 그 부재를 통해 가족들이 엄마를 찾아 나서는 이야기입니다. 엄마를 찾는 과정에서 가족들은 엄마가 처음부터 엄마로 태어난 사람이 아니라는 것, 엄마도 우리들처럼 이 세상에 태어나 처음으로 배운 말이 엄마였다는 것을 깨달아갑니다. 결국 엄마도 엄마가 필요한 사람이었다는 것을 이야기하지요. 엄마가 필요한 엄마조차도 껴안을 수 있는 큰 어머니 같은 역할을 내 소설이 하기를 희망합니다. 내 작품이 이미 소멸한 것이나 지금 위험에 처해 있는 것에 마음을 주고 그것을 살려내고 복원시키고 근원을 상기시키는 데 복무하기를 바라는 이유가 거기에 있습니다. 어렸을 때부터 엄마가 없을 때 내가 강아지며 텃밭 채소를 돌보면 윤기가 없고 비실비실한데 엄마가 돌아와 며칠만 돌보면 다시 생기가 넘치고 생생하게 되살아나는 것들이 항상 신비롭고 궁금했어요. 내 소설이 이런 어머니의 손길처럼 죽어가고 있는 것들을 돌보아 살아가게 했으면 하는 바람으로 나는 씁니다.
Compassion underlies my works, since most of what inspires me as a writer brings out a feeling of pity in me and makes me explain, oh, how sad, you poor thing. They stay with me and turn into my stories. Youth, the most glorious time between birth and death, exists for all living things. And because life undergoes constant and ceaseless transformation, I write. I write about the dignity and the beauty and the pathos of all things that change. My writing may not solve anything, but I always hope that it will remain next to the people on the fringes of society, providing them the comfort and warmth of an embrace. Compassion, I believe, is at the heart of motherhood, And if motherhood can symbolize the act of caring for all who suffers from lack and conflict and senselessness, then my writing is an attempt to approximate a mother's love. Among my recent works is a novel called Please Look After Mother. This story was born out of the recognition that even a mother needs a mother. In the story, a family tries to cope with the mother's absence after they lose her in a crowded train station. As they search for the missing mother, the family learns that she wasn't born a mother, but rather became one. And as with everyone else, the first word she learned was mama. In short, even a mother needs a mother. I hope that my work can serve the need, become a mother figure that nurtures even a mother in need of a mother. When I was a child, I was always mystified by the fact that our family dog and even the vegetables in the garden would seem to grow listless and dull whenever my mother was away. And I was equally fascinated by how my mother could restore their vivacity after a few days of tending to them. I continued to write with the hope that my writing, like the magical touches of my mother, can look after those things that are dying away so that they may continue to live.
이 한국에서 엄마를 부탁해 표지는 이렇게 생겼는데요. 이 작품을 잠깐 제가 첫 부분을 낭독을 하겠습니다. 그리고 최경희 선생님은 뒷부분, 네, 저보다 조금 많이 길게 낭독을 하겠습니다.
So, she will read the first part of the novel in English, Please Look After Mom, and English in Korean, 엄마를 부탁해. And I will read a little bit more length, the last part of the novel.
엄마를 잃어버린 지 일주일째다. 오빠의 집에 모여있던 너의 가족들은 국립 끝에 전단지를 만들어 엄마를 잃어버린 장소 근처에 돌리기로 했다. 일단 전단지 초안을 짜보기로 했다. 옛날 방식이다. 가족을 잃어버렸는데, 그것도 엄마를 잃어버렸는데 남은 가족들이 할 수 있는 일은 몇 가지 되지 않았다. 실종 신고를 내는 것, 주변을 뒤지는 것, 아무나 붙잡고 이런 사람 보았냐고 묻는 것, 의류 쇼핑몰을 운영하는 남동생이 인터넷에 엄마를 잃어버리게 된 이유와 잃어버린 장소와 엄마의 사진을 올리고 비슷한 분을 보게 되면 연락해달라고 게시하는 것. 엄마가 갈만한 곳이라도 찾아다니고 싶었으나 이 도시에서 엄마 혼자 갈 수 있는 곳은 없다는 것을 너는 알고 있었다. 글을 쓰는 사람이니 문안 작성은 내가 해라. 오빠가 너를 지명했다. 글을 쓰는 사람, 너는 해서는 안 될 일을 하다가 들킨 것처럼 기미치 붉어졌다. 과연 내가 구사하는 어느 문장이 잃어버린 엄마를 찾는 데 도움이 될지. 1938년 7월 24일생이라고 엄마의 생년월일을 적는데 아버지가 엄마는 1936년생이라고 했다. 주민등록상에만 38년생으로 되어 있을 뿐 실제로는 36년생이라는 것이다. 너는 처음 듣는 얘기였다. 아버지는 그 시절엔 다 그렇게 했다고 했다. 태어나서 100일을 넘기지 못하고 죽는 아이들이 많아서 2, 3년 키워본 다음 호적에 올렸다는 것이다. 38이라는 숫자를 36이라고 고쳐 적으려는데 오빠가 신생 명세서이니 38년생으로 적어야 한다고 했다. 이건 우리가 만드는 전단지이고 여기가 동사무소나 구청도 아닌데 사실보다 등록된 것을 적어야 하나 의문이 들었지만 너는 묵묵히 36이라 적은 숫자를 다시 38로 고쳤다. 그러면 7월 24일이라는 엄마의 생일은 제대로 된 것일까 생각하면서 너의 엄마는 몇 해 전부터 내 생일은 따로 챙기지 마라 했다. 아버지의 생일이 엄마의 생일 한 달 전이었다. 예전엔 생일이나 다른 기념할 일이 생기면 너를 비롯한 도시의 식구들이 제이시 엄마 집으로 이동하곤 했다. 다 모이면 집게만 22이었다. 엄마는 식구들을 모이는 왁자한 상태를 좋아했다. 식구들이 모이게 되면 며칠 전에 새김치를 담그고 시장에 나가 고기를 끊어오고 치약과 칫솔들을 준비했다. 돌아갈 때 한 병씩 나눠주려고 참기름을 짜고 참깨, 들깨를 따로 볶아 찌었다. 가족들을 기다릴 즈음에 너의 엄마는 동네 사람들이나 시장 통해서 만나는 사람들과 얘기할 때 단연 활기를 띠었고 은근히 자부심이 변하는 몸짓과 말투를 보였다. 헛간에는 엄마가 철 따라 담가놓은 매실즙이며 산딸기즙이 담긴 크고 작은 유리병들이 즐비했다. 도시의 식구들에게 퍼줄 황석어젓이며 멸치속젓이며 조개젓갈들이 엄마의 항아리들을 가득 채우고 있었다. 양파가 좋다는 말이 들리면 양파즙을 만들어서 겨울을 앞두고는 감초를 넣은 늙은 호박즙을 짜서 도시의 식구들에게 보냈다. 너의 엄마 집은 도시의 식구들을 위해 사시사철 뭔가 제조하는 공장과도 같았다. 장이 담가지고 청국장이 발효되고 쌀이 찌어지는.
It's not in the plan, but I will read. It has been 1 week since Mom went missing. The families gathered at your eldest brother Hyungchul's house, bouncing ideas off each other. You decide to make flyers and hand them out where Mom was last seen. The first thing to do, everyone agrees, is to draft a flyer. Of course, a flyer is an old-fashioned response to a crisis like this, but there are few things a missing person's family can do, and the missing person is none other than your mom. All you can do is file a missing person report, search the area, ask passers if they haven't seen anyone who looks like her. Your younger brother, who owns an online clothing store, says he posted something about your mother's disappearance describing where she went missing. He uploaded her picture and asked people to contact the family if they'd seen her. You want to go look for her in the places where you think she might be, but you know how she is. She can't go anywhere by herself in this city. Hyungchul designates you to write up the flyer. Since you write for a living, you blush as if you were caught doing something you shouldn't. You aren't sure how helpful your words will be in finding Mom. When you write July 24th, 1938, as Mom's birth date, your father corrects you, saying that she was born in 1936. Official records show that she was born in 1938, but apparently she was born in 1936. This is the first time you've heard this. Your father says, everyone did that back in that day, because many children didn't survive their first 3 months. People raised them for a few years before making it official. When you're about to rewrite 38 as 36, Hyungchul says you have to write 1938 because that's the official date. You don't think that you need to do so precise when you're only making homemade flyers and it isn't like you're at a government office, but you obediently cross out 36 and write 38, wondering if July 24th is even Mom's real birthday. A few years ago, your mom said, "We don't have to celebrate my birthday separately." Father's birthday is 1 month before Mom's. You and your siblings always went to your parents' house in Cheongup for birthdays and other celebrations. Altogether, there were 22 people in the immediate family. Mom liked it when all of her children and grandchildren gathered and bustled about the house. A few days before everyone came down, she would make fresh kimchi, go to the market to buy beef, and stock up one extra toothpaste and toothbrushes. She pressed sesame oil and roasted and ground sesames and perilla seeds so she could present her children with a jar of each as they left. As she waited for the families to arrive, your mom would be visibly animated, her words and her gestures revealing her pride when she talked to neighbors or acquaintances. In the shed, mom kept glass bottles of every size filled with plum or wild strawberry juice, which she made seasonally. 'So I will read the last part, several pages, it's a little bit long. Only after mom went missing did you realize that her stories were piled inside you in endless stacks. Mom's everyday life used to go in a repeating loop without a break. Her everyday words, which you didn't think deeply about and sometimes dismissed as useless when she was with you, awoke in your heart, creating tidal waves. You realized that her position in life hadn't changed even after the war was over and even when the family could afford to feed itself. When the family got together for the first time in a long while, sat around the table with the father and talked about the presidential election, mom would cook and bring about the food and wash the dishes and clean and hang damp dish racks to dry. Mom took care of fixing the gate and the roof and the porch. Instead of helping her to do the work that she did nonstop, even you thought of it as natural and took it for granted that this was her job. Sometimes, as your brother pointed out, you thought of her life as disappointing, even though mom, despite never having been in a comfortable situation, tried so hard to give you the best of everything, even though it was mom who patted your back soothingly when you were lonely. Around the time tiny new leaves started to sprout on the ginkgo trees in front of City Hall, you were squatting under a large tree on a main thoroughfare that led to Samcheongdong. It was unbelievable that spring was coming. Without mom here. That the frozen ground was thawing and the trees were starting to wake up. Your heart, which had sustained you throughout this ordeal with the belief that you would be able to find mom, was crushed. Even though mom's missing, summer will come, and fall will come again, and winter will come like this. And I will be living in a world without mom. You could imagine a desolate road and the missing woman plodding down the road wearing blue plastic sandals. Without telling anyone in the family, you left with Yubin for Rome, where he was going to attend a seminar. He would ask you to come with him, but didn't expect you to say yes. When you actually decided to go with him, he was a little taken aback, thought he patiently arranged for a few things in his schedule. The day before you were to leave, he even called you to ask, "Nothing changed, right?" As you got on the Rome-bound plane with him, you wondered for the first time whether mom's dream was travel. Mom would always worry and tell you not to get on planes, but when you came back from somewhere, she would ask you detailed questions about the place you visited. What kind of clothes do Chinese people wear? How do the Indio carry their children? What was the most delicious food you had in Japan? Mom's questions would spill out onto you. You'd always reply curtly, "Chinese people take off their shirts in the summer and walk around like that. The Indigo woman I saw in Peru carried a child wrapped in a sack on her hip. Japanese food was too sweet." When mom asked more questions, you got annoyed and said, "I will tell you later, mom." But you had no opportunity for these conversations later because you always had something else to do. You leaned back in your airplane seat and heaved a deep sigh. It was mom who'd told you to live someplace far away. It was also mom who sent you at a young age to live in a city far from your birthplace. Mom, back in those days, you realized painfully that mom was the same age as you are now when she brought you to the city and left, taking the night train back home. One woman. That woman disappeared, bit by bit, having forgotten the joy of being born and her childhood and dreams, marrying before her first period and having five children and raising them. The woman who at least had it came to her children wasn't surprised or thrown off by anything. The woman who was marred with sacrifice until the day she went missing. You compare yourself with mom, but mom was an entire world unto herself. If you were mom, you wouldn't be running away like this, running away from fear. The entire city of Rome is literally a historical site. All the negative things you heard about Rome, there is a transit strike every other day. They don't even apologize to the passengers. People will pull your arm toward them and steal your watch right under your nose. The streets at night are blighted with graffiti and garbage. You didn't care. You just observed everything passively, although you were ripped off by a taxi driver and someone grabbed the sunglasses that you had just placed next to you at a cafe. You went various ruins by yourself during the 3 days when Newbin was at his conference. To Forum Romano, the Colosseum, the baths of Caracalla, and the catacombs, you could listlessly in the spacious ruins of the largest city. Everything about Rome symbolized the civilization, but although the traces of the past were spread out in front of you wherever you went, you didn't keep anything in your heart. Right now, you're looking at the statues of saints in the round piazza, but your eyes do not pause anywhere. The guide explains that Vatican City is not only a country in a secular world, but also God's country. That the territory is only 44 hectares, but an independent state with its own currency and stamps. You aren't listening to the guy's explanations. Your eyes jump from person to person. Even if there are only a few people around, your eyes leap among them, unsettled, as you wonder. Is mom here somewhere? There's no way that mom would be among Western tourists. But even now, your eyes don't know how to pause on a single object. Your eyes meet the eyes of the guide, who'd said that he came here 7 years ago to study vocal music. Embarrassed that you're not even wearing the earphones, you pull them up and plug them into your ears. Quote, Vatican City is the world's smallest city, but the 30,000 people visit in a single day, unquote. As you hear the guy's explanation transmitted to ears, you bite the inside of your lip. Mom's words come to you in a flash. When was that? Mom asked you what the smallest country in the world was. She asked you to get her a rosary made of rosewood if you ever went to that country. The smallest country in the world. You suddenly pay attention. This country? This Vatican City? With your earphones still on, you wander away from your group, seated under the marble stairs, away from the sun, and go into the museum alone, a rosary made of rosewood. You walk by the majestic ceiling art and a row of sculptures whose end you can't see. There has to be a gift shop somewhere which might have a rosewood rosary for sale. As you weave quickly between people in your quest to find this rosary, a rosewood rosary, you pause at the entrance to the Sistine Chapel. Michelangelo hung on the beams of those tall ceilings every day for 4 years to work on the fresco. The sheer size of the large fresco overwhelms you, so different from the way that it looks in books. Yes, it would have been strange if he didn't experience physical problems after finishing this project. The artist's pain and passion gush down like water onto your face as you stand under the creation of Adam. Your instincts are right. When you leave the Sistine Chapel, you immediately see a gift shop and bookstore. Nuns in white are standing behind display cases. Your eyes meet those of one particular nun. Are you Korean? Korean comes out of the sister's mouth. Yes. I came from Korea too. You're the first Korean I've ever met since I was dispatched here. I arrived 4 days ago. The sister smiles. Do you have rosaries? Rosaries? Rosaries made of rosewood. Ah, the sister takes you to one part of the display case. Do you mean this? You open the rosary case the sister hands you. The scent of roses bursts out of the airtight rosary case. Did mom know the smell? It was blessed by a priest this morning. Is this the rose of the rosary mom talked about? Is this the only place you can get this rosary? No, you can get it anywhere. But since it is the Vatican, there's more meaning to it if it comes from here. You gaze at the sticker on the rosary case, 15 euros. Your hands shake as they give the money to the nun. Still holding the rosary case, the mom asks as if it is a gift. Gift? Could I give this to mom? Could I? When you nod, the nun takes out from the inside of the display case a white envelope with the image of Pietà printed on it, puts the case inside and seals it with a sticker. Holding the rosary in your hand, you start walking toward St. Peter's Basilica. From the entrance, you look inside. Light cascade from the round ceiling above the majestic bronze ciborium. Angels float among the white clouds in the ceiling fresco. You set one foot in the basilica and look beyond the large lacquered halo across the way. As you walk down the center aisle toward it, your feet pause. Something pulls at you intensely. What is it? You wade through the crowd toward the thing that is pulling at you like a magnet. You look up to see what people are looking at. The Pietà, the Holy Mother holding her dead son is ensconced behind the bulletproof glass. As if you are being dragged forward, you push toward the crowd to the front. As soon as you see the graceful image of the Holy Mother holding the body of her son who had just breathed his last breath, you feel as though you are the frozen in that spot. Is that marble? It seems that her dead son still has some heat in his body. The Holy Mother's eyes are filled with pain as her head tilts down at her son's body laid across her lap. Even though death has already touched them, their bodies seem real, as if poking finger would dent their flesh. The woman who was denied her motherhood still gave her lap to her son's body. They are vivid, as if alive. You feel someone brushing against your back as you look swiftly behind you. It's as if mom is standing behind you. You realize that you habitually thought of mom when something in your life was not going well, because when you thought of her, it was as though something got back on track and you felt re-energized. You still had the habit of calling mom on the phone, even after she went missing. So many days, you went about to call mom, but then stood in place numbly. You placed the rosewood rosary in front of the Pietà and kneel. It's as if the Holy Mother's hand, cradling her dead son by his armpit, is moving. It's hard for you to look at the Holy Mother's anguish as she holds her son who had reached death after enduring pain. You don't hear anything, The light from the ceiling has disappeared. The cathedral of the smallest country in the world falls into deep silence. The cut on the tender skin on the inside of your lip keeps bleeding. You swallow the blood that pools in your mouth and manage to raise your head to look up at the Holy Mother. Your palms reach out automatically to touch the bulletproof glass. If you can, you want to close the Holy Mother's sorrowful eyes for her. You can sense Mom's scent vividly, as if you too had fallen asleep under the same blanket last night and you embraced her when you woke up this morning. One winter, Mom wrapped her rough hands around your young, cold eyes and took you to the furnace in the kitchen. Oh my, your hands are sheets of ice. You smell the unique fragrance of Mom, who huddled around you before the fire, rubbing and rubbing your hands to warm them. You feel the Holy Mother's fingers, which are wrapped around her dead son's armpits, stretching out and stroking your cheek. You remain on your knees in front of the Holy Mother, who barely manages to raise her son's hands, clearly marked by nail-inflicted wounds, until you can't hear footsteps in the cathedral. At one point, you open your eyes. You stare at the Holy Mother's lips, beneath her eyes, which are immersed in sorrow. Her lips are closed firmly, with a grace that nobody could disturb. Deep sighs escape your lips. The Holy Mother's dainty lips have moved beyond the sorrow in her eyes toward compassion. You look at her dead son again. The son's arms and legs are splayed peacefully across his mother's knees. He is soothing him even in death. If you told anyone in the family that you were going on a trip, they would have taken that to mean that you had given up on finding Mom. Since you had no way to convince them otherwise, you came to Rome without telling anyone. Did you come here to see the Pietà? When Eubin suggests that you join him in Italy, you might have unconsciously thought of this sculpture. Perhaps you wanted to pray in this place, pray that you could see for one last time the woman who lived in a small country attached to the edge of the vast Asian continent to find her. This is why you came here. Then again, maybe that wasn't it. Maybe you already understood that Mom didn't exist in this world anymore. Maybe you came here because you wanted to plead. Please don't forget Mom. Please take pity on Mom. But now that you are the statue on the other side of the glass, sitting on a pedestal, embracing with your frail arms all of mankind's son, sorrow since the Genesis, you can't say anything. You stare at the Holy Mother's lips intently. You close your eyes, back away, and leave that place. A line of priests pass by. A line of priests passes by, probably on their way to celebrate Mass. You walk out to the entrance of the Basilica and look down, dazed at the piazza, surrounded by long cloisters and enshrined in a brilliant light. And only then do the words you couldn't say in front of the statue leak out from between your lips. Please, please look after Mom.
Well, my mom is in the audience, and I think I should make sure to remember that. Okay, we'll proceed without our coffee break. We'll welcome Mr. Kim Hyung-ha to the stage, and he'll be reading and discussing his texts, text without translation. He'll be able to do both Korean and English versions. You could follow along in your programs. There's a transcript for the passages that are being read.
Hello, 김영아입니다. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Hyung-ha Kim. So actually, at first I was told I have to prepare the 5 minutes introduction to my novel that I'm gonna read. But yes, but we have a little time for. Yes, 6 o'clock. By 6 o'clock, we should move. So, okay, the same on the radio, and I don't have to walk more. So, at least I can still walk less. That's good. Yes. The novel that I'm going to read is "Your Republic Is Calling You." Is the recently published in. The stage, the September, so that is, and but the original title is The Empire of Light, 빛의 제국 in Korea, so the cover is totally different. So for for United States authors and for the Korean, the readers and Korean audience. Yes, and this story is it's about the spy, so forgotten spy. So my editor in New York so wanted to to promote this book as a spy novel, and it can be a hook. So in the back cover, so. A foreign film importer, Kim Ki-young. Ki-young is a family man with a wife and daughter. He is also a North Korean spy who has been living among his enemies for 21 years. Suddenly, he receives a mysterious email, a directive seemingly from the home office. He has one day to return to headquarters. Yes. It's quite, looks good. The original version of Korea, as in the back cover, there was nothing. Yeah, because in Korea, I am a renowned writer, so my editor in Korea didn't have to, so explain the blah, blah, blah. But yes, I understand my the editor in New York. She's brilliant, but she, has to sell the books, but so this morning I found I watched the TV so in the hotel in the campus, and I found today is a big day. It's a big football match, right? Yes. So 3:30 Iowa and the Michigan University. So 6 years ago, I was in Iowa University. So I know what this kind of event is like. So wow, what a perfect timing. So for a literary event. So why you are here? So you're great. So weather and so I saw so many young students in blue. Yellow, the marching to the football stadium. So, Yeah, it was moving. So, but I was thinking about the novel. So, novel is similar to, yeah, a little bit similar to the football games. So, I think the novelist is like the quarterback. Sometimes, yes, I, you know, I have my characters. So, someone is fast and someone is, you know, so. Some muscle guy, and I gave the ball to him and the others. So, but the difference is I have no spectators. So, and I have no, you know, the TV shows in my room. As a lonely, I write my novel with my characters, like a ghost, and without no rivals. And, I fought with my ghost characters. Yeah. That's the job of mine. So this story is not, yeah. Yes, I have some, so I hired a good character for this novel. It's Forgotten Spy. Yes, it's, because he is, I think the character, the Forgotten Spy can be a, you know, observer to watch the Korean society and the Korean human being as an outsider out of the, you know, the inner circle of Korea. So he lives in, he has lived in Korea for 20 years, and the 20 years in North Korea. So he is on the borderline, so he can observe the, so both sides. So this novel became a story about an illegal immigrant. Yes, he is, yeah, kind of illegal immigrant. He cannot observe himself to the, you know, the both society, so North Korea and South Korea, anything else, anywhere else. So when I finished this novel, I found that this story, it can be, you know, so about the these days, so many people so move the more and more, and so even in South Korea, you know, the South Korea is was a very homogeneous country, but even in South Korea, so millions of the immigrants, including illegal immigrants, live there. So the mingled and the mingled. So we should so have to. So study that we should have to learn to live with, you know, the strangers and the illegal immigrants or the legal immigrants. So I found that when I published this novel, I found the Korean American in Korea, in Seoul. So many friends of mine liked this novel. They, I guess that they didn't know why they liked this novel, but I think they, I thought they must be, you know, so they thought they regard as they, themselves as a kind of illegal immigrant. In Ki-young's word, the in protagonist describes himself as a transplant tree. So I think that part, you know, captivated my friends in Seoul. Okay, so I'm gonna read a small part of the book, so in Korean and in English. So actually, I am strong in Q&A session, but I think there will be no Q&A session, but that's okay. Okay.
그는 1963년 평양 태생이었다. 그러나 남으로 내려오면서 67년생 김기영이라는 이름과 신분을 부여받았다. 서울 태생의 고아였던 67년생 진짜 김기영은 17살에 시설을 나온 뒤 실종되어 주민등록이 말소된 상태였다. 그에게 껍데기를 빌려준 김기영이란 자는 어디로 가버린 것일까? 가끔 그는 진짜 김기영이 돌아오는 꿈을 꾸곤 했다. 얼굴이 지워진 사내가 그의 침대 머리맡에 서 있었다. 아무 말이 없어도 그가 진짜 김기영임을 알 수 있었다. 1985년 봄, 그는 용산의 한 동사무소에서 말소된 주민등록을 복구하고 열 손가락에 지문을 찍고 김기영이라는 일면식도 없는 사내의 이름으로 새로운 주민등록증을 발급받았다. 동사무소에 있던 고정관첩은 피곤해 찌든 중년의 남자였다. 혁명적 열정에 불타는 청년일이라는 예상은 빗나갔다. 모든 일을 마친 뒤 동사무소 직원과 종이컵에 든 커피를 복도에서 나누어 마셨다. 동사무소 직원은 마치 명절을 앞두고 비상경계에 투입된 경찰관 같은 말투로 말했다. 잊어버린 줄 알았는데 용케 찾았네. 갑자기 나타난 기억이 달갑지 않은 기색이었다. 게다가 대뜸 반말이었다. 잊어버리다뇨? 아, 손님 본 지가 오래돼서. 그러면서도 슬쩍 기영의 눈치를 살폈다. 그는 태우던 담배를 모래 속에 비벼 넣었다. 아, 언제 한번 올라가 봐야 되는데 영 짬이 안 나는구만. 위에 누가 계십니까? 있기야 있지. 누가요? 어머니는 평양의 순안구역에 사시고 외삼촌은 아마 청진에 계실 테고. 아, 그러시다면 언제 한번. 그는 재터리에 칵 가래침을 뱉었다. 이제 와서 가면 내가 잘 살 수 있을까? 그럴 수 있을까? 네? 어린 네가 뭘 알겠냐는 얼굴로 남자는 입가를 일그러뜨리며 웃었다. 아무것도 아니요. 하여튼 몸 조심하시오. 남자는 왼손에 들고 있던 종이컵을 찌그러뜨려 쓰레기통으로 던졌다. 그리고 다시 동사무소 안으로 돌아갔다. 모든 꿈과 희망을 잃어버리고 연료통 밑바닥에 가라앉은 몇 방울의 냉소를 연료 삼아 겨우 굴러가는 사람처럼 보였다. 권태가 걸음걸음 바지자락을 타고 뚝뚝 떨어졌다. 김정일 정치군사대학의 공작원반, 흔히 130 연락소라 부르는 그곳을 막 떠나온 기영은 그의 허무주의적 태도가 조금 놀라웠다. 이런 적지에서 전두환 역도가 광주에서 수천의 인민들을 백주에 학살하는 땅에서 긴장도 적개심도 없이 살아가는 것이 가능하단 말인가? 그러나 지금아 돌이켜보면 권태와 허무야말로 이 사회의 특질이었다. 권태는 무차별적으로 퍼져 있었다. 기영은 권태가 무엇인지는 알았으나 그것을 실제로 목도하기는 처음이었다. 그가 떠나온 사회에서 권태는 자본주의를 비판할 때나 등장하는 추상적 개념이었다. 물론 그곳에도 권태는 있었다. 그러나 사회주의 사회의 권태는 차라리 무료에 가까운 개념이었다. 다시 말해 그것은 적절한 동기부여가 부족한 상태를 할 수 있었고 따라서 어떤 자극만 주어진다면 금세 사라질 가볍고 허망한 것이었다. 그러나 처음 맞닥뜨린 자본주의적 권태에는 무게와 질량이 있었다. 그것은 삶을 짓누르고 질식시키는 유독가스처럼 느껴졌다. 단순히 곁에 있는 것만으로도 두려움이 생겼다. 가끔 어떤 종류의 인간들은 보는 사람들로 하여금 즉각적으로 아, 저렇게는 살고 싶지 않다 라는 원초적인 경계심을 불러일으킨다. 어떤 경로로 포섭되었는지도 모를 그 동사무소 직원이야말로 그런 사람이었다. 권태와 우울, 허무와 냉소, 후줄근한 옷차림과 매력없는 용모가 어우러진 잠시라도 함께 있기 불편한 인간이 되어 있었다. 자, 이제 영어로 읽겠습니다. 네, 바로 이어지는 대목은 아니고요. 네, 잠깐 건너뛰어서 읽겠습니다. 기영이 지하철 속을 헤매는 그런 대목입니다. Kyung pretends to drop his ticket on the ground and glances quickly behind him. He feels his gut fold over his glance, his belt as he bends down. Once upon a time, he boasted a taut physique with hard muscles, envied by members of the combat team. The very fact that he spent time with the combat agents, professional assassins who specialized in infiltration and escape, meant he was in good shape. But that was a long time ago. He is becoming an average middle-aged South Korean man, his belly round, his chest puny, and his arms jiggly. People relax when they look at his belly. They assume that someone like him can't be a mugger. It's safest to be a man who is uninteresting, neither too old nor young. Someone living a settled life. The kind of man who supports his family but is ignored by them. These ordinary men sometimes take part in risky transactions when the opportunity presents itself, their hearts racing, trying to believe they are safe because everyone does it. They can become mired in a bog of corruption, perhaps in the form of kickbacks, bribery, or slush funds, and they don't foolishly dream that they can wade out of it.
Nothing has changed since their college days when they clandestinely studied Kim Il-sung's Juche idea. Some men say that being involved in politics is like balancing on prison walls, morally precarious. But Ki-young believes that this is the common fate of all men. Those men who were once bewitched by illegal ideology in college are probably leading the same mundane life as Ki-young. They would have realized the harsh reality that is capitalism and quickly given their all to the world into which they were born. Wading through the most dangerous moment of his life, Ki-young knows nothing other than that an order was issued. I want to know more. I want to know more. I want to know more. Ki-young thirsts to know not what is going on, but whether he is the only target. He needs to know whether the others are aware of what is going on. Why was he given order for? Was his identity revealed, or did he inadvertently leak something? The two possibilities sound like the same thing, but they are actually very different. If it is the former, the authorities are recalling him for his protection, the latter, to punish him. But there is no way to know which it is until he returns. During the Cold War, the KGB had overseas spies return to Moscow under the pretext of holding an important discussion, then killed them. A furnace waited for the moles who aided the enemy. The shamed spies were slowly slid into the smelter's melting iron, surrounded by their colleagues, like the Terminator. Of course, sometimes there really was a discussion, and afterward they would be sent back out again. I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. I don't know a thing. Ki-young has no idea what is happening. He has been living as a forgotten spy since Lee Sang-hyuk was purged. As he hasn't engaged in very many activities, there hasn't been much chance to be discovered. But you never know. It is possible that he unwittingly made a fatal error, or it could always be a misunderstanding. Anyway, he has less than a day. He has to find something out, anything, before the deadline. There has to be a clue somewhere. I'm sure there was some kind of sign, but I just didn't notice it. What happened to me in the past few days? Was there an old phone call or a stranger following me? If there had been, wouldn't I have noticed it? No, his senses could have been dulled because he's been living complacently for so long. By now, he is standing on the subway platform. He hears the announcement that the train is about to arrive. He draws in a deep breath, inhaling it all, like he is going to cherish these scents forever. Minute dust particles, the smell of car lubricant, liquor on the breath of an old drunk, the perfume of a young, sexy woman. He holds his breath, then exhales slowly through his nose. Right then, the subway train rattles past him and slows. The people on the platform wait patiently for the doors to open, standing docilely on the footprints on the floor, pasted behind the yellow line to encourage queuing. Will I have to go back? Will I be safe if I go? Will I even be able to decide whether to go or not? Why would I go back? No, I can't. I can't. I can't go back. He places a hand on his forehead and steps back. The doors open and the people rush out of the car and the quicker ones push in and find a seat. Ki-young continues to waver as he takes in the scene inside the car. The announcement that the car will leave soon, the automatic door vibrating, impatient and ready to shut at any moment. The black-hatted conductor sticking his head out to check the platform, the provocative jeans ad on the side of the car, the model's sexy ass sticking out like a dog's, the seagull-shaped stitching on the pocket emphasizing the curve of her behind, The dirty floor covered in black splotches of spat out chewing gum. The calm gazes of passengers sitting inside. He can't decide whether to get on or not. Finally, the car doors bang shut as if yelling, "Get out of here." He feels as if a door were slammed in his face or as if his innermost secrets have been revealed. The people sitting in the subway car leaving the station look at him as if they could see the dark, murky waters churning in his heart. They smile conspiratorially and look back at him standing immobile on the platform. "Asshole, know your place, act your age and status. We all learned what we can and can't do under this system. Don't you know it's a crime not to follow those rules? Go back to the empire of strong red paint strokes, the country where children blowing on their frozen hands to keep them warm turn their cars in unison to create an ever-changing backdrop in the stadium during the mass games, where people scorn women for wearing jeans. Your republic is calling you." Everyone seems to be yelling at him from inside the subway car, their hands cupped around their mouths. He imagines plugging his ears with his hands, but that wouldn't drown anything out. The subway car headed toward Ponghwasan leaves behind a sharp metallic screech as if refusing to hear Ki-young's reply and resolutely disappears into the dark tunnel. He is the only one left standing on the platform. He is overcome with emotion. There is something sweet about this cheap sentiment. His eyes closed, Ki-young revels in his memories. He wants to wiggle deeper into his own wet insides, into the warm darkness, like a snail thrown on the ground. He wants to close his eyes and ears and stay somewhere safe and forget about the odor. Isn't it possible that someone will call him tomorrow and tell him it is all a joke? At that moment, someone bumps into him. His eyes fly open. It's a young man with spiky burgundy hair, wearing ripped baggy pants. The young man stops, pulls up his earphones, and bows politely. "I'm sorry." He seems sincere, although his appearance would suggest otherwise. Ki-young tells him it's okay and goes to sit on a bench. The young man plugs his earphones back in and perches on the edge of a bench, bopping along to his music. His hairstyle and face remind Ki-young of Bart Simpson, and his loose red t-shirt is emblazoned with Che Guevara's face. He is probably listening to Rage Against the Machine or some similar band. The most capitalist country in the world produced these far-left lyrics, and on the CD, filled with the imagery of a Vietnamese monk sitting cross-legged while engulfed in fire, young soulites throwing Molotov cocktails. The singers swear, scream, and yell that we have to smash the system. It's fitting music for the kid in the Che Guevara shirt. If Stalin and Lenin were alive to hear this music, what would they think? Would they feel the urge to send the band to the Siberian archipelago? Five laborers, wearing dirty pants and carrying a red flag, pass Bart and Ki-young, following the yellow line drawn on the floor. There must be a large workers' rally in the afternoon. They are talking among themselves. They are uninterested in Che Guevara. They concentrate on their own problems, the rise in part-time positions, the once trusted leftist government's anti-labor policies, and the asshole employer who keeps evading collective bargaining negotiations. Now that he has one day left in this world, every cliched image in front of his eyes comes to life. He greedily observes everything that the world scribbles at him, his entire being having turned into a dried up, brittle piece of recycled paper. Like an amateur poet burning with creativity, Like a young boy who experiences his first kiss, everything around him becomes poetry. He notices things that form a contrasting resonance, like Bart Simpson and Che Guevara, or irony, like the jeans model and the shabby workers bearing a red flag. People seem to be actors who suddenly appear to awaken his sensitivity toward capitalist society, as if to remind him that he isn't observing a scene in a play. Another train clatters into the station. When the doors slide open, Ki-young enters the subway car, brushing past a Sikh in a turban. Cheap perfume assaults his nose, then dissipates. He looks for an empty seat and sits down. Right before the door is about to shut, someone runs up and sticks his foot in the gap. The door reopens and he gets on. Ki-young's senses spring to attention. Is this man following him? Did he wait until the last moment because he was worried Ki-young wouldn't get on or that he would get off as soon as he got on? The man, wearing a black jacket and overly shiny shoes, walks slowly toward Ki-young and sits next to him. He has a free newspaper in his hand. The car isn't empty, but there are open seats other than the one next to him. As soon as the man sits down, he starts reading his newspaper, but Ki-young feels that the whole thing is unnatural. If he's a tail, which side is he on? If the man is the agent in charge of supervising Ki-young's return, it would be smarter not to go back north. If they trust him, he won't be followed. This means he probably did something wrong, and that's why they are bringing him back. But if the man is with the South National Intelligence Service, it would be better for Ki-young to follow the order and return obediently. Then order 4 would have been sent to ensure his safety, to ward off the arrest, the torture, and the possibility that he would, in a state of hallucination and desperation coming from the injection of narcotics and the lack of sleep, blow the others' identities, putting them in jeopardy. All he has to do is figure out which side the suspicious man is walking for. His newfound poetic sensibility disappears in a flash, and he assumes the armor of prose, of detachment. He glances at the paper the man is reading. No hints are forthcoming. Ki-young takes out his cell phone, pretends to look for a text message, and flips his phone open and shut several times. Finally, Ki-young makes up his mind and stares into the man's face, as if he just discovered that someone was sitting next to him. He sees that the man is starting to look unsure. Ki-young opens his mouth. Do you believe in eternal life? Thank you.
Okay, we have a little bit of time for Q&A. We'll welcome Ms. Shin Kyung-suk back onto stage, and we'll take questions from the audience. We'll take questions in both languages, Korean and English.
신경숙 선생님, 그 작중화자 너를 사용을 하셨는데요. 그게 선생님 작품의 특수한 어떤 그런 부분인지 아니면 한국 문학 전반적인 어떤 현상인지가 궁금하고요. 아, 개인적으로는 굉장히 효과적인 장치라고 생각을 하셨답니다.
소설 한국의 어떤 특징은 아니고요. 이 소설의 그 엄마를 잃어버리고 난 가족들 네 사람의 목소리 를 따로따로 한 사람씩 냈습니다. 그래서 너는 딸, 그는 아들, 그리고 당신은 아버지, 그리고 엄마만 나라고 얘기하는 그런 구성으로 짜여져 있는 소설입니다.
It's not
목소리들, 각기 다른 목소리로 구성된.
It's not at all typical of Korean fiction, but it's unique. And merited by the organization of this particular novel. which is divided into four different sections, and each section has a different voice. So you, as the second person voice, was dedicated to the perspective of the daughter. He was the son. And then there's an honorific you. The first you dedicated to the daughter's voice was a non-honorific you. And then the honorific you was devoted to the voice of the mother's husband, father. And then only mom's voice was captured in the first person. Oh, yes, absolutely.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I 자살이라는 테마를 그 자기 치유의 과정으로 이렇게 묘사를 하신 걸로 제가 기억이 들어요. 그래서 자살이라는 주제를 일단 선택을 하신 것도 되게 그 당시 상황 뭐 자살이란 말을 반대로 해서 뭐 살자라는 그 사회적인 뭐 이런 그 무드가 한창 조성이 된 상황에서 그런 주제를 테마를 선택하신 거하고 그다음에 그거를 또 이제 상당히 좀 어떻게 사회적인 반향을 일으킬 수 있는 치유의 과정으로 이제 묘사를 하시면서 과연 이게 어떻게 받아들여질까라는 생각을 집필을 하시면서 혹시 하셨는지 궁금하고요. 그래서 뭐 굳이 여쭤보자면은 창작의 자유와 그리고 이제 작가의 어떤 사회적인 책임이라는 측면에서 좀 여쭤보고 싶습니다.
Okay, the question concerns, my question to Mr. Kim Young-ah concerns his fiction, earlier fiction of mid-90s called I Have a Right to Destroy Myself, which revolved around a suicide guide and concerned the theme of suicide. And incidentally, suicide or 자살 in Korean, reversed in order, means 살자 or to live. So in fact, that's precisely the tack that Mr. Kim took in thinking of suicide as a process of self-healing, ironically. Mr. Kim perhaps aimed at making a kind of a social splash with that ironic twist. In conjunction with what you did in that novel, I also wanna ask you your thoughts on the relationship between one's work and the social responsibility of a writer.
Yes, I wrote the novel I Have to Do to Destroy Myself in 1996. So, yeah, long time ago, 14 years ago, so originally published in Korea. At that time, the suicide was not a major issue in Korea. So, after I finished my novel, I didn't know that before I finished the novel. So I found my novel was the first novel, you know, the theme was about the suicide. I thought it surely had been some other novels in Korea, but no. So I didn't concern about the suicide in these days. Many people so gathered to kill themselves in a motel, isolated motel in the rural area. But when I wrote the novel, I didn't notice that the phenomenon. But after I published the novel, 3 years later, 4 years later, in Japan and in Korea, they'll popped up the website to arrange the suicide and arrange, match the people. But I can say I was not responsible that phenomenon because my novel was not sold not that much. So yeah, only just a few the literary connoisseurs and the fans read the novel. But basically, I think this is my philosophy of writing. So writer is not responsible for the social phenomenon. So like, you know, someone makes the knife, someone makes the gun, and he is not responsible for the specific the killing, murdering, and when I wrote that novel, the suicide helper is not the kind of you know, some doctors in the United States. He is similar to the Kiyong in the UL Republic is calling you. He's just the observer. You know, I wanted to invent, I wanted to adopt, I wanted to hire a character to who can listen carefully to their clients. So after I deciding the theme and the world, no. So I just needed a character to listen the stories of others. So, yeah, suicide was not my main concern. Okay.
In the interest of time, I think most of us understand English here, so I'll just translate. We'll take the next question.
여원 선생님한테 질문하고 싶은데요. 그 스파이 노블이라고 된 거에서 불만이 있으신지 아니면 뭔가 좀 뭔가 이렇게 저번 며칠 전에도 그저께도 한번 얘기를 하셨어요. 본인이 혹시 그걸 장르를 규정을 한다면 뭐라고 하셨을 것 같은지 제가 그 빛의 제국을 몇 년 전에 검은 꽃이랑 한꺼번에 읽어가지고요. 지금 제가 인상을 가지고 있는 거는 코미디 굉장히 희극적이다라고 생각하면서 읽었었거든요. 근데 그 스파이 노블이라고 하면 그것이 가져다 주는 어떤 미국 사람들이 이런 걸 상상하지 않을까 하는 선생님이 가지고 계신 어떤 우려도 조금 있는 것 같고 그래서 그 부분을 스파이 노블이라고 두 번이나 두세 번 언급을 하셔갖고 한번 듣고 싶습니다. 어떻게 규정을 하고 계시는지.
In European countries, there is no strong genre tradition of spy genre tradition, but in the United States, in Cold Era, there was a big, you know, trend of a spy novel, John le Carré and other the spy, the thrillers. So, yeah, I knew that my novel so could be, you know, regarded as a old-fashioned the spy novel. So, but in European countries, the European audience didn't regard the novel. So the critics and the journalists didn't regard this novel as a spy novel. I think they respected me, I think. But the context is different, the United States. And the North Korea is a very important nation in the United States. Almost every day you can see the news about the North Korea in the CNN and the Fox News. You know. So yes, it can be a selling number, but I think this novel, The UL Republic is calling you. Yes, it is. It has a very comic. So the things like the last sentence I read, do you believe in eternal life? It's very absurd. And So at Bart Simpson, he thought a guy so who bumped into him is a think thought the Bart Simpson, Che Guevara, and even though he was in bad condition and he, you know, tried to keep thinking about outside world. Yeah, so he was trained as a spy. So yeah, so I cannot say this novel is a specific genre, but I can say yes, coming novel. It can be humorous, hilarious, black humor. Say this black humor, something like that. But if you are not very well, you know, so trained the readers, you cannot find the humor.